of the Republic of Texas, and we just had a business meeting here. And then we wanted to invite you to our program. I am also a member of the DeWitt County Historical Commission, and I'm chair of the marker committee for the Historical Commission. And one of the things that we did this past year was, of course, this year is the 175th anniversary of the founding of DeWitt County. And so we've been celebrating all year long. And one of the things we did was to create a historic sites guide. And so there are probably enough for everybody here. I got a bunch. And so you're welcome to take one of those. I am also a descendant of three colonists in DeWitt's colony: George Washington Davis, John Gladden King, and James Hodges. And so DeWitt's colony is dear to my heart. So I want to know who's in the audience first, and I want you to know who's in the audience. So all the DRT members, I'll let their hand. We did put out that our registrars will be here after the program, and if there's anybody who's interested in finding out eligibility to be a member of DRT, they can talk to you about that. Okay, how about DeWitt County Historical Commission members? Well, our Lavaca County Historical Commission.
Whatever, I'm with you guys. We're going to call it the Antioch County.
He comes to our meetings too.
All the time.
How about what?
I'm on the Wilson County Historical Commission.
Wilson County Historical.
What county?
Yes, let's hear it for all.
Yeah, it's on the Tim County.
Okay, how about Green DeWitt Community members? Okay. How about DeWitt colony descendants? Is there anybody here? Yes. Anybody else that is a descendant? Maybe. Not sure. Okay. There are actually 21 members of Gonzales Chapter DRT that are descendants of DeWitt colonists. And our membership, we have 70 some odd members. I can't remember the upright number right now. But many of them live far away, but they want to be a member of the Gonzales chapter because that's where their ancestors came from. And so we have members in the Dallas area, the Houston area, the San Antonio, Austin, even El Paso. We have members out there. And we have members in other states. We have members in Georgia, Nebraska, Arizona, California, New Mexico, Virginia, Colorado, and North Carolina. So they all came from this area and are proud to be Texans. So we put it out there. Okay, so this program today is about DeWitt, Green DeWitt and his colony. And I've put kind of an outline here. I've put a map that I did the best.
Yay on that map.
Any of you who had Mrs. MacDougall for seventh grade Texas history? Yeah, right, okay. We would come in on Monday morning and the chalkboard would be full. We would have all this information up there, assignments we were supposed to do during the week, and resources and all kinds of things. The chalkboards would all be there. And so I was channeling Beulah Margaret MacDougall. We all loved her.
She was, what was her?
What?
What was her connection to history?
Well, she was a Bennett.
She was a Texas history seventh grade teacher.
Yeah. I know, but she was connected to the
right.
Texas.
Valentine Bennett.
There we go.
Was her ancestor.
Right. Got a question. Is that part of Venice or up in Lavaca County? There's a Venice Cemetery in Lavaca County. Is that part of the same bunch? The Venice Cemetery in Lavaca County?
Bennett Cemetery could
in
be.
In Lavaca County. I'll drive by Sweet Home.
Close enough. Yeah.
Very close.
It's a cemetery,
it could be.
I think I heard something about that too from Bennett.
Wow. Okay, so we're going to start off talking about DeWitt's colony, and we have to talk about Texas before the colony. Spain was the first European country that claimed land in the land that would eventually become the Republic of Texas. And so for 200 years, the Spanish conquistadors were conquering and occupying Mexico and much of Central America and South America. But they didn't feel like they really needed to worry too much about that part up there in the north. And so they didn't do much until the French came in and Fort St. Louis was founded on Garcitas Creek, wasn't it? Oh, kind of on Malabar Bay. And so then Spain got a little worried about that, and they thought, they may lay claim to that property over there. So that's when the presidios and the missions started being founded. And they thought they had the Native Americans, they would make them loyal Spanish citizens, and they would have a claim to the land then. But not a lot of Spanish colonization occurred at that time. And Fort St. Louis failed, and so there just wasn't much going on here. There was very little non-native population in the area for quite a period of time there. Now, after the American Revolution, pretty soon the United States started wanting to expand west. And so Thomas Jefferson thought it would be wonderful to have control of the Mississippi River, because the port of New Orleans down there was really vital to shipping from any of the agricultural products anywhere west of the Appalachian Mountains. That shipping could go down the Mississippi much easier than it could go over the mountains and go out to the Atlantic seaboard. So he wanted that area. And then in 1803, the Louisiana Purchase gave that all of that property, and actually way out to the west some of it, to the United States. Come on in. Here is another. I'm a corporation member.
Yes, I went to the wrong place, and a hassle of dogs greeted me.
I see the paw prints. And So the Louisiana Purchase, 1803, but with the Louisiana Purchase, the United States and Spain didn't agree on what that western boundary was. There was some dissension about that. The United States had also tried to buy Florida from Spain a number of times, and Spain, of course, never would sell. But finally, the Florida Treaty of 1819 was signed, and that gave Florida to the United States, and it established the boundary. The Sabine River was the boundary between the United States and Mexican Texas. Yeah, that's where I want to see it. Mexican Texas, Texas, Mexico. Oh, okay. So anyway, that was the situation when Moses Austin first petitioned the Spanish government to start a colony in the area that would be Texas. And now Spain was pretty against Anglos from the United States coming in here. They had a pretty strict policy because there had been a number of invasions from the United States into Texas. The Gutierrez-McGee expedition, of course, was one of the bloodiest. And so Spain didn't like those Anglos at all. But with the influence of Baron de Bastrop, Moses Austin died, and Stephen F. Austin took over his dream to have a colony in this area. And so Baron de Bastrop was, he had come into Texas and claimed that he was a Dutch nobleman. I don't think there's a lot of support for the fact that he really was. Anyway, he had gained influence with the Spanish government in San Antonio. He was actually second alcalde there in the early 1800s, 1810 or something like that. And so he was influential with the Spanish authorities, and he helped Stephen F. Austin get his grant approved. So it was approved in 1820, 21, I'm not exactly sure the dates, but right after that, Mexico won their independence from Spain. He got his contract with the Spanish government, and then the Mexican government took over. So he had to get them to confirm that contract, which he did. Okay, so soon after that, a lot of other men started saying, let's go to Texas and let's have a colony down there. We'll get lots of free land. And Green DeWitt was one of those. And he saw how Austin's colony was taken off, and he thought, well, I'll go down there and do the same thing. Green DeWitt was born in, he was a Kentucky native. His wife was from Virginia, but then they were in Missouri. He was in his mid to late 30s, I think, before he came to Texas in 1822, the first time he came. In Missouri, he was a sheriff there for a while. There's not a lot of information about him. But anyway, he set his sights on Texas. So he came over here in 1822 and started trying to get a contract with the Mexican government. Well, he was turned down. He did not get it. But with all that was going on and all the interest in settling in Texas, the Mexican government began to pass laws then, colonization laws, to govern how this was going to take place. And so the colonization law of 1824 was passed in Mexico City, but they also let the Mexican states pass some regulations of their own. So what happened is, an impresario, the word impresario is the Mexican word for entrepreneur. And so impresarios would enter into a contract with the Mexican government to settle families on designated land. And for every 100 families they settled, they were supposed to get 5 leagues of land. 5 sitios of grassland, grazing land, and 5 labors, which is 177 acres, I believe, of land that was suitable for cultivation. Now land could also be obtained directly from the Mexican government. You could either by grant, by special grant, or you could purchase it from the Mexican government. But if the land was in a designated area for an impresario, you have to get the impresario's permission also. So there was some work to be done with all that. Also, the contract said that it had to be vacant land. If there was anybody already there and they were legally there, then you could not displace them. So with Austin and Bastrop's influence, DeWitt's petition was finally granted on April 15, 1835, and it was approved by the Mexican government and by the government in Saltillo, Coahuila, which was the state. And his contract specified that he could settle families. Now here, if you can see it, it stands here. I tried to draw it on here, but I didn't want color on here because color doesn't erase all this very well. He could settle families all the way from the Malacca River to a line parallel southwest of the Guadalupe River, 2 leagues southwest of the Guadalupe River. And this is the Bahar Nacogdoches Road that went from San Antonio all the way up to Nacogdoches. So that was the top of it. And, you know, this is Austin. He was pretty close to Austin up here. I didn't ever realize that his grant went that high. And then there was a limit down here because you couldn't be within 10 leagues of the coast. They didn't want settling there. So this was these dotted lines right here in the Lavaca River. Those were the assigned lands that he could colonize. And so he started doing that. He had to bring these people in at his own expense, but in exchange, the Mexican government guaranteed their personal safety of personal safety and safety of their property. They would, they said that they could enter into any, they could engage in any honest pursuit. That was their work, job that they could have. And they were exempt from taxes. Now, one of the laws said 10 years, one of the laws said 6. There was a little disagreement over that on down the road, too. But they had to swear to, the settlers had to swear to uphold the federal and state government laws. They had to be of good Christian, had to swear to their Christianity and moral character. As a matter of fact, they had to have documents from wherever they came from that said they were of good moral character. And they had to agree to participate in the Roman Catholic religion. So those were the requirements. So, DeWitt named James Kerr his surveyor, and he started surveying land. And Kerr, at the confluence of the Guadalupe River and the San Marcos River, he picked out a spot there for the capital of the colony and named it Gonzales, after Rafael Gonzales, who was the, I don't remember what his title was, but he was the head guy down there in Saltillo. And so he named it Gonzales. Now, that settlement started, he got his contract in April 1825. August 1825, the first family, Francis Berry and his family, came to Gonzales. And within that year, before the end of that year, there were 7 more families that came into the Gonzales area. Now, about a year later, there was an Indian attack on that settlement, the settlement at Gonzales, and only one man was killed, but all the survivors moved away for a while. They went back closer to the Colorado River. So it was abandoned for that period of time. Now, in the meantime, Kerr had started a station at the mouth of the Laca River, right here. This is Matagorda Bay and Malacca Bay, and so somewhere right about there, he created a station. He called it Old Station, and it was the area where immigrants could come. They usually came down the Mississippi or somehow to New Orleans, and then they came across the Gulf of Mexico on a schooner, and they came, then they got here. And so there was a station there to receive them. Now, Kerr went to San Antonio, to the political chiefs there, and tried to get permission to let them settle in that area. But it was less than 10 leagues off the coast. So the political chief said, no, you cannot settle there. You can keep a station there for receiving immigrants, but you can't have a settlement. Okay, the people, they didn't pay too much attention to that. And there was a disagreement about where the 10 leagues should start. Would it be down here, right there where the tidewater was, or was this also a part? You know, did it have to start here? You know, there was a disagreement about which water you had to be 10 leagues off of. And so when they told them to move, there was, they had already planted crops. They were settling in there. Mexican impresario Martin de Leon had received a grant in 1824, the year before Greenwood got his. But they didn't designate his land. They didn't say where he could settle. And so, actually, I think it was when DeWitt was coming from Saltillo in 1825, he comes back up, he keeps trucking along up here, and he's finding settlers all over his land. And so he said, what is this all about? Well, he went to the authorities, he appealed to them, and they said, well, yeah, we made a mistake. But they have legal right to that land. You can't kick them off. And so you have to honor their property rights. And Devon was already starting a little settlement down here called Victoria. And he said, you have to leave that alone too. Victoria can be there. Of course, it was actually out of his designated lands, but they told him he had to honor that. So, but you know, the dissension between De Leon and DeWitt's colonists, between them and their colonists, was never really settled very well. So in 1826, about the end of 1826, there was a man came into the colony, and he was going to be a merchant. So he had a bunch of a cargo of all these goods that he was going to sell. Well, within his goods, he had some tobacco. You know, Virginia, all those people up there, they had tobacco, you know. The Mexican government strictly forbade tobacco. You cannot have tobacco. And so that was contraband. Okay, so there was apparently a spy or a De Leon friend in the DeWitt colony over there at Old Station. And because De Leon found out there was tobacco. Aha. So he got the authorities, and they came over there and they seized all this man's property. I think the man's name was Pato. For sure. Anyway, they seized all of his goods, what he was going to sell. Well, they went back and forth. They finally gave back all of it except the tobacco, and then maybe they weren't, and maybe they were going to take it again. But at one point, De Leon was with the military authorities as they came from La Bahia, from Goliad, and they were coming over there. And the people at Old Station was hearing about this military invasion, and so they armed themselves and they were ready to fight. Well, that all kind of settled down too somehow. I think Austin might have been there. He was the one that just calmed everybody down and said, "Oh, let's all get along." But anyway, there was a full-out battle was averted. But they did take DeWitt first to Goliad, and then to San Antonio for a hearing, you know, about whether he was doing what he was supposed to do. And so it all turned out okay, and they turned DeWitt loose. But they told him that all those people settling over there on the Lavaca River, at the mouth of the Lavaca River, had to move to Gonzales. Well, it was August 1826, and they had... Their crops were planted, and the roads were bad, and the wagons weren't in good shape, and you know, they kept getting extensions on when they had to be out and when they had to be in Gonzales. Well, the people in Gonzales that had all left there in July of 1826 came back about the beginning of 1827, and by the end of that year, by the end of 1827, all the people that were settling in at the Lavaca River had moved to Gonzales, so there were more people there then. Now they kept people there for receiving the others, you know, but as far as settling in, they weren't there. Okay, land titles in the General Land Office include the date of arrival as well as the date of the title. And so titles, we can see this is how many people came in 1825 into DeWitt's colony. Seven in 1825. These are families, not individual people, but families. And when they say families, I'm pretty sure, because a lot of them were single men, and so I think a single man would have been considered a family also in terms of these titles. So in 1826, only five, 1827, 12, 1828, 9, 1829, 35, 62, and 32. So those were the years that they came into DeWitt's colony. And so you can see that it started off kind of slow, but then it was really picking up there. So who were these colonists, and why did they suffer hardship to come to Texas? George Washington Davis, I already told you he's my great-great-great-grandfather, he wrote a letter in his older years, after his wife had died, I believe. He wrote it to his sons, and he starts it off and says, "It occurs to me that someday, if not now, you may want to know more about from whence you come, He goes on and on. And he does a lot. He writes, writes a lot. But this is what he wrote about coming to Texas. I had long heard of Texas, its rich soil, fine climate, its beautiful scenery, and the advantage of getting large tracts of land there for almost nothing. I had pondered upon all these things for a long time, but the distance was so great, that country was so far off, the heavy expense of going there, the risk, the hardship, privation, and dangers a family would be exposed to in making the voyage, all conspired to detain me a long time from the undertaking. But now I had excited your mother's enthusiasm on the subject, and her sense led her to see the great advantage that would most probably result from the enterprise. And cheered on by her assistance and smiles of approval, I determined to brave all hazards and make one strong, daring effort to better a condition and secure a future competence for myself and my family. So that's part of what got people coming to Texas. Now, sometime in 1830, the Mexican government had passed a law that any immigrants coming in from the northern frontier, read United States, had to get a passport from the Mexican authorities. But it apparently wasn't enforced for anybody en route to Austin or DeWitt's colonies. Now, we've all heard that there were a lot of other colonies, you know, but none of them ever flourished very much. Austin and DeWitt were the two that made the biggest splash, and that may be why. Maybe they kept those people out. I'm not sure. By 1830, DeWitt had 100 colonists in, so he could. When he had 100 colonists, he had to let the Mexican government know so that they could appoint a commissioner, and then the commissioner would issue title to land. And nobody had received title all this time. The ones that came in 25, you know, all the way to 30, they still didn't have title to their land, even though they were there and improving it and living on it. And so Jose Antonio Navarro was appointed commissioner, and he started issuing titles. I think all the titles had his name on them. And when you look at it, there were 19 titles There's a book here, and I've got it up there as one of the sources, that was written in 1903 or 1904 on Green DeWitt's colony, and it lists they had done the research in the General Land Office with all the colonists that came in and when they came and when they got their title. And so all of them got their titles in either in 1831 or 1832. But there were 19 titles that were granted by the government, and two of them were dated 1833, and two of them were dated 1835. Probably those last four grants or titles were granted by the government, not by Green DeWitt himself, and they were probably granted after his contract expired. He tried to get his contract extended, but they didn't extend it for him. So April 15th, 1831, he was out. No more could he do that. So George Washington Davis arrived in March of 1831, just a month before he actually got here in January, but he didn't claim his land until March. And so he also wrote about coming into Old Station down there. After he described his family's trip down the Mississippi from St. Louis, he wrote, "At last we got passage on board of the schooner Emblem from Matagorda, Texas. We embarked on her about the last of January, 1831. left the Mississippi and went to sea. The third, and then he describes how they had a storm and everybody was seasick, but I don't remember that. The third day after leaving the Mississippi, we entered Matagorda Bay at the Paseo Caballo. And that's right down there by Indianola, Paseo Caballo, if anybody has studied that part. And had a tedious passage up the bay, getting aground at last on the 12th of February, 1831. We landed at Cox's Point on the Lavaca Bay. Now see, you got Matagorda Bay here, but then Lavaca Bay comes up here a little bit, and Cox's Point is probably right about there. And it's still on some maps, I see. About 20 miles from any house on the naked and lonesome bay shores, our crowd of passengers, for there were 80 or 90 of them on vessel, made it for a while a lively and populous place. Here we put up camps or tents and remained about 2 weeks before we could get away. The roads then were so bad there that wagons could not travel them. We procured plank from the captain of the vessel, built a sort of flatboat. I got our passage in her for helping to build her and afterwards helping to work her up the Lavaca River. So they came up the Lavaca River. I probably made Navidad get too close there. But we ascended the Lavaca and the Navidad in her as far as Old Scott's, where we landed. Here I again had to build a camp. I did, and a very snug one with poles and palmetto leaves. February. There actually is, on maps that I have now, this is the Navidad right here, and there is a bend in it called Palmetto Bend. So I'm assuming he might have been right about there, building his snug little camp out of poles and palmetto leaves. Okay, so he continued and wrote, from the meager description of the country, which I had only been able to obtain, and from the idea I had formed of it, I had, when I started, fixed upon the Guadalupe River as having the country on it that would please me best. After we landed, in a few days, I met a man who was going to Gonzales and wanted company, and I, anxious to hunt a home, soon agreed to go with him to the Guadalupe River. Accordingly, I shouldered my rifle, and on foot, with half dollar in my pocket, all the money I had in the world, and a little wallet of provisions with the best heart I could muster, leaning on hope alone, set out. Now, his wife, Rebecca Warfield Gaston Davis, was pregnant when he left her in that snug little camp of holidays. She was 8 months pregnant, actually. And he describes her situation, he puts it in his letter too, not about her being pregnant, but he says, your mother, when on the river, that was the Mississippi River coming down to New Orleans, when on the river on the way to New Orleans, became afflicted with rheumatism, and so severely that when I left her on the Navidad, she could not walk without crutches. The rest of the family, except Sidna, were entirely helpless. We had brought provisions with us to last us some time, or they would have suffered. His stepdaughter, Sidna, was 16. John Gaston, his stepson, was 12, and his son, Eugene Davis, was 2. So that's who he left in that snug little camp. Rebecca gave birth to a son on March 24th, while her husband was in Gonzales. After selecting a league of land on the east side of the Guadalupe River, so here's the Guadalupe, I didn't put Coral on there, but it would be right about there. So he's about 7 miles north. You know, when you're going on 87 towards Gonzales, you cross Cuero Creek. Well, George Davis's property was on both sides of Cuero Creek, but on the left-hand side of 87 down towards the Guadalupe River. And he sent a letter back to Rebecca in the camp. Somehow there was mail. And he said, the land was first-rate quality, very rich, well-timbered, having good water, being healthy and free from mosquitoes. He was real pleased with himself. He also purchased lots in the town of Gonzales, because Gonzales had been laid out at that time, and built a home there, as many of the colonists did. So that is the story of Green DeWitt's colony and the dreams and hardships of those who came. Having settled 100 families, DeWitt was entitled to receive 5 leagues of land for his own use. And one of them, one of the leagues that he received was right here. This is Green DeWitt League. According to field notes, and I have them, I have a copy of them right here, he received title in 1832 to a league situated on the southwest side of the Guadalupe River, a little below the Bahia Road. I'm not sure where the Bahia Road was. This league was has within it about 4.5 acres of land fit for cultivation without the facility of irrigation, and all of the rest good grassland. So that's in the survey notes. I haven't found deed records to show the continued possession of this league of land that Green DeWitt received. It may have reverted back to the Mexican government if nobody lived on it and improved it, I'm not sure. But what I have found, there are multiple deeds transferring parcels of the land, never the whole league itself, in the 1860s and 1870s. That was a period of time when immigrants from Germany began arriving. Now, Louis Koenig was an Alsatian immigrant. Alsace was sometimes France and sometimes Germany, you know, it kind of went back and forth right there. But he was an Alsatian immigrant who purchased this land right here in the Green DeWitt League in 1877. He began farming and raising stock. He married in 1879, and he raised a family of 12 children. The first log cabin he built still stands nearby. It's on this lady's property. She's married to a descendant of Louis Koenig. I'm married to a descendant of Louis Koenig. Anyway, Koenig didn't want his children to have to cross the Guadalupe River to go into Pueblo to school. So he donated an acre of land, he said, from his front pasture for a school in 1900. Now, there was never a church, there was never a commercial business, anything in this area, but the community just grew up. The school was called Green DeWitt School, there's Green DeWitt Road right out there, and this has always been Green DeWitt community. The school actually took in all of the Green DeWitt League and also parts of adjacent leagues, the Charles Amsler League, William Deardorff, J.B. Lockhart, A. Kirkendall, Charles Lynn, and A. Neal leagues. So those are all names, many of them sounding Anglo, but maybe some of them are Germanish, I don't know. Anyway, so that's how this is Green DeWitt School, the community center. When they quit using it as a school in 1951, the building and the property was deeded to the Green DeWitt Community Club. And with the stipulation that if the community club quits using it, it goes back to the heirs of Louis Koenig. And so this is not the original building from 1900. That one burned in 1929, but this building was built in 1929, and the records show that it was built for less than $500 by the families in the community. And so since the school closed, it's just been the community center. So I hope you have enjoyed learning that bit about this area and the school of Texas. Any questions? I may know the answer.
I do. One of the things, I did some research on the Matthews Wells house for the tours. And one thing I read, I wanted to confirm, is that Thomas Matthews built the Wells house, but his father, and his first name, the name of the father escapes me, but he apparently, said in his notes that Green DeWitt was having problems getting those 100 people or however many he needed to fulfill his contract. And he hired Matthews to help him get bring some families. And Matthews was responsible for bringing 20 of those people, and I'm not sure, 20 of the families. And he went out and gathered them up. And for that, Green DeWitt, or whomever, gave Matthews quite a bit of acreage. And so anyway, and then he died, I think, pretty soon after that. But by that time, Thomas Matthews had been born. He was one of several sons, and each son got, I think, 1,000 acres. So he'd amassed quite a bit. And that's who built the Wells House. So anyway, I just wondered if you'd ever heard that connection about Matthews being hired by Green DeWitt.
I had not heard that, but that doesn't mean it's not true. Okay. He was out there. Green DeWitt apparently he let Kerr kind of run the colony, James Kerr, his surveyor, and he kind of went back and forth a little bit. He did bring his family here. I'm not sure, I read it, but I can't remember right now how soon he brought his family. But he would go back and forth trying to get these immigrants to come.
Well, I try to always tie the tours, because we're the DRT, to the Republic of Texas, even though it was built in 1885. And that's one of the things I say, well, I'm hoping it's true, because I can't read that. So, anyway, but I thought you were like the expert. So, anyway, I just say Thomas Matthews, the money to build this house came from, that, what I just said. So,
any other questions or comments? Thank you all for coming. I'm just really excited. And some cupcakes over there. There's still some coffee, I believe. If there's not, we can make more.
That map's wonderful. Is that what's in that book? I have that book. Is it that map that you gave?
Okay, I didn't point these out. This is something I got off of the Portal to Texas History. University of Texas, North Texas, and that's what I used to get this here because it tied in so many of the places that I wanted to talk about. This one was, just about the Louisiana Purchase. The white is the Louisiana Purchase, and of course, it shows it going way up here. But there it was in Louisiana where they disputed the boundary between, once the United States got it, Mexico said, or Spain said, "Whoa, you didn't get all that. That's not where the boundary is," because France owned the Louisiana Purchase when it was received. And then this is the quarterly in 1904. Ethel Zwickau wrote quite an extensive, I think it was a dissertation, on DeWitt's colony. And there is a map here. If you think you have any connection to any of those colonists, because it shows all of the leagues and areas that they got. And there is.
We sell that at the Wells House, by the way.
Oh, yes.
And I was told, I think by Betty, that there's only a few left now, and that once those are gone, they're gone.
Yeah, it was reprinted in 1968, it was original.
There's very few left of that last printing or something. I don't know if that's...
The City of Gonzales reprinted it in 1968. I think Gonzales Chapter has all. I think after the city redid it, I think what they had left, they gave to Gonzales Chapter.
The city didn't want them anymore, so they gave them to the DRT.
Yeah.
So can I reserve one?
I'll
say
that for you.
Thank you.
We had about 25 of them.
And there's also, in her appendix, she has all the names of all the settlers and the alphabetized, so you can find
and how many slaves they brought, and all that, and how all that kind of stuff.
Is the guy
more yes. And but Mexico, what's one of the things you can think about? You had to be a Catholic, but you couldn't have slaves. And so what they did, because all these Kentucky and Tennessee wanted to bring the slaves, and who was going to work the land. And so they kind of classified them in some way, like indentured servants or something like that, so they could get past that Mexico not wanting slaves because they were coming from slave states.
Yeah.
So I think that's...
I love the tobacco. What you said about the tobacco. Yeah, I was like...
Wow.
Weren't they progressive?
Yeah.
Tobacco.
But aren't they the worst smokers in the world?
Yeah, now look at
I've never seen anything like that. And a lot of times they smoke just to get rid of mosquitoes.
Oh, that's true.
Drugs either, did they?
They wouldn't have liked them.
Or the wealth associated with it.
I've always been confused about where the concept of Indianola, Indian Point, and Old Station, and now I got, okay, Old Station had to do with DeWitt.
Right.
And his columns having to have a place.
Yeah, I think I got it right. Yeah.
And I've heard of Cox's Point.
Yeah.
And then, of course, we all know about Linville.
Well, see, in his letter, he mentions Old Scots, and I've never found another reference to that, so I don't know what that was. You know, he said they came up, maybe it wasn't in the part I read.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
Yeah, we ascended the Lavaca and Navidad as far as Old Scots, where we landed. And
so there must have been an individual?
I don't know what that
possibly
was. Lost. As our history will be if we don't keep talking it.
Yeah.
So, anybody that wants a historic sites guide, do you want a historic sites guide? Help yourself. If you want to look at these things, do.
Great, Margie. That was really good. I enjoyed it.